I walked up the high butte today. I had the giant, dark wedge of chocolate cake. All the lights were circling, exalted and repeated.
So, thank you very much for speaking with me on this edition of In the Field, the Outsound Presents channel. Talking to Philip Greenleaf and Claudia LaRocco. Is that correct?
That's the Italian way. That's fine.
Oh,
yes.
Okay. How would you like your last name pronounced?
I'm good with that or with LaRocco.
LaRocco.
Okay.
LaRococo.
Is not so good.
Excellent. Okay, not so good. Great. Well, these are great opportunities for me to also get names before I have to announce people. Philip and Claudia are performing at the Outsounding Music Summit this year Wednesday the 26th.
Yes.
That's right. True. Wednesday the 26th.
We'll be there.
Yes. And I'd like to find out a little bit more about what you guys are up to and some of the background that you have in terms of how you have created this project that you're going to be presenting. So maybe, Claudia, you can tell us a little bit about what, you started doing at an early age with music, poetry, writing,
yeah.
And what influences brought you to experimenting within that field.
I was not doing music at an early age at all, other than sort of failing to even learn how to play the recorder. So that's
okay.
Music was not it. Writing has always been my thing. Mm-hmm. And I worked for a long time as a critic, and my background is as a poet. So mm-hmm. the two types of writing that I've done are basically those, which is sort of over time formed into this kind of hybrid, mm-hmm. Hybrid form. I don't think music was on my horizon at all, other than something I really loved until Philip and I were in residence at Headlands Center for the Arts in 2013. One day he asked me to contribute text to one of his map scores, and so I wrote some very short poems. And then in the fall, he's like, why don't you perform with us? And that was the first time.
When did you write your first poem? How old were you?
Second or third grade.
Yeah, do you still have that poem?
It might be somewhere in the, family household.
I want to see that.
I asked that question because having worked with beat poet Ruth Weiss, she actually has the poem she wrote at the age of 5, and she occasionally reads it when she does readings now. So now I ask poets when they first wrote it, if they still have their poem sitting around somewhere.
I do have the first book I ever made, which was in kindergarten.
See?
Okay. Which was done in crayon.
Right.
Yeah.
Appropriately.
So. I was avant-garde.
So you were a writer from the start.
Yeah. Definitely.
Great. And just in general, what kind of music were you into then, and how, you did a residency, so, with Philip, right?
And mm-hmm. As a writer.
Yeah, it was multidisciplinary, yeah. And I was putting together a book at the time, did not have music on the brain.
But it has to be there somewhere, or else you would be sitting here talking to me.
I would say that the major way in which I was exposed to and understood music was that I worked as a dance critic for years and years, and so I was often, I was in the theater 5 to 7 times a week, and sometimes that meant watching dance in silence and the rhythm of what they were doing. Sometimes that meant, bad recordings. Sometimes that meant, incredible musicians like, Zena Parkins. So sort of the gamut of music.
Okay, so you've been exposed to a wide range of music for quite some time.
Yes.
Right, okay. Well, now that makes sense to me, and hopefully to our listeners. And so, Philip, tell me a little bit about what you grew up starting with. Was saxophone your first instrument?
No, the guitar was. I, fell in love with records mm-hmm. long before I started school, and I became a record collector, like, pre-kindergarten, you know. I don't know how it happened. I think I was reading Peanuts, or my mom was reading Peanuts, those Charles Schulz cartoons, and Schroeder was always talking about Beethoven, and the Beatles were really big then, and, you know, so my parents said, well, what would you like for Christmas? I said, well, I want a Beethoven record. I want a Beatles record. So my first two records were Beethoven's Third Symphony and the Beatles' 45 single, I Want to Hold Your Hand. And then it just became known in the family with all my cousins and aunts and uncles and grandparents. Yeah, give him a record, you know, for his birthday, you know. So, yeah, by the time I was in second or third grade, my cousins had given me records by all the big groups in the mid-60s, you know, like the Rolling Stones and the Beatles and whoever, you know.
Right.
But I liked classical music, too. Again, I think it's just Schroeder from Peanuts. And to this day, that Third Symphony just really rocks me. But, so I was asking for a musical instrument, and then finally in second or third grade, my parents gave me a guitar and a Mel Bay guitar book, and I tried to teach myself, and that was really frustrating. Eventually, in fifth grade, the school sent home that piece of paper saying, join the school orchestra.
Oh.
And my dad said, well, I can play the trumpet. I'll help you if you want to try the trumpet. So I played trumpet until the end of seventh, you know, took lessons, learned how to read.
Right.
But by the middle of seventh grade, I just hated the music we were playing. And I wanted to be able to play like Jimi Hendrix on the trumpet. And maybe that's, you know, that's kind of interesting when you think of how today maybe my saxophone voice accesses electronic music and things, you know.
Yeah.
Non-saxophone language, you know,
right.
Just kind of trying to expand the way the saxophone sounds. So I threw out the trumpet, I bought an electric bass and continued to play that and bought another guitar, a nicer guitar, and took lessons and was mostly a guitar bass player through high school, just jamming with my friends. I didn't want to be in the school band anymore. That just wasn't like a rewarding experience. I wanted to jam and play the kind of music I was listening to. Until 12th grade, when I heard a recording with Wayne Shorter on it, and then he was playing soprano on some track, and I said, wow, okay, the soprano saxophone. It had a very interesting sound to me that I really tuned into, so that was the first saxophone that I had. I rented a soprano, and my dad saw that I was really into it. I went off to college as a music major, and he gave me my tenor, which I've been playing since December 77, coming up on my 40th anniversary of playing that particular saxophone over there. So that's how I got started, I guess.
Well, you know, Wayne Shorter, that's a great introductory to the world of jazz and improvisation, you know. He skirts that edge, but there's more to that, I'm sure. I mean, could you elaborate on maybe what is it that brought you more towards the exploring the saxophone itself and maybe going out of that range?
Sure.
You know?
Well, I discovered Wayne my senior year of high school, but then I went off to school to college and became a music major. And I had Jerry Moore, the father of Michael Moore, the saxophonist in ICP, and Greg Moore, who was with Wilhelm Breuker's collective for a long time. Their dad was my first serious music teacher, you could say. And I studied jazz. I studied saxophone with him. I studied jazz theory. I had an ethnomusicology class with him. And I was going to the music library a lot. And I picked up this Marion Brown duets record with Leo Smith and Elliot Schwartz. And I had already heard Coltrane's Late Period, you know, which is jazz. To me, at that, I never drew all these lines that people seem to want to draw between these musics, you know. To me,
I think that's a place where our collaboration, like, really Like, it's one of the places where we really connect is that we're both decidedly uninterested in categories.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, your work. She was telling you her work. Mm-hmm. She was writing, you know, for the newspaper every day, and then she just wanted to write criticism that on the page looked a lot more like poetry than so. Seeing that work when we first met really excited me. I agree with you. I think we're not so interested in labels and and.
Well, you just move between so many. There's so many different types of music. Mm-hmm. So I think I move through different types of writing, but I've also sort of been restless in art forms. You know, I've collaborated with a lot of dance artists and theater artists, and I like seeing. I like asking people to do things they're maybe not comfortable doing.
So I see.
Asking myself to do that sometimes.
Right.
And I think, like, so when you would say, you know, that you wanted to just teach yourself how to be able to talk to an electronic musician through your horn, that's something that makes so much sense to me.
Yeah. Okay. And I would think that that goes back to that record I just mentioned, you know,
right.
Marion Brown's playing with Elliot Schwartz and right. Leo, and they're playing what the art ensemble called little instruments, you know, that one piece on that record where Marion Brown is on this side of the basketball court, and I think it's Elliot Schwartz on this side of the basketball court. The court is full of instruments, and the score is, you know, they have to sort of work their way across the court to the other side, playing any instrument that comes in front of them.
Right.
And so all that sound on that record, you know, all the what people might call non-traditional sounds and non-professional approaches to these instruments was really exciting to me. I can't tell you. And it just freed me up. And I think that record... So, yeah, so to me there's never been any need to draw these lines between these genres. It's just music.
Okay. Yeah. No, that starts to make sense now. It's I can see the collaboration.
Yeah.
That's.
To me, it was discovering. Well, one of the. I mean, it was just. It's like you discover artists, and then it's like, oh, here's a door that I could walk through. There's a room I could go into.
Right.
Jill Johnston's criticism. She was writing for the Village Voice in the 1960s, and it's ostensibly dance criticism, and it's some of the most interesting writing about performance that I've ever read, but it's also. It's also something totally other, and it's just, it's not an either or. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So, your project, Animals and Drafts, mm-hmm. which you're bringing to Summit this year, I'm assuming it sounds like you use a lot of these elements we've been talking about in this particular project. Extending past the ethos of the sounds of the instruments and going places that may be uncomfortable for everybody involved, both on both sides of the stage. Am I correct in that assessment?
Possibly.
Yeah, possibly. Okay.
I don't know. I mean, my feeling is, you know, I think it was really scary for me to do this because I do have an improvisation practice, but it's as a watcher and writer. So... For years, I was doing pieces where I was attending a show, and I would sort of write for the length of that show. And so it's a 45-minute piece, then I would do 45 minutes worth of writing, and that would be the piece that I would publish. So this idea of writing that, you know, wouldn't be edited, it would just be in making decisions in real time and shaping a composition sort of moment to moment, which was improvisation on the page, but I don't have, you know, I'm not a vocalist, and I... don't have a practice as an improviser in performance. So to work with these incredible artists who have thought for so long and worked for so long in that vein was really intimidating. Mm. But it was also really, really sort of delicious. I mean, they were all so generous. And, you know, I don't know how the experience was for them, but for me, it just felt like I could... sort of go anywhere, or I could be this weird found object that maybe couldn't move in all of these ways because they could move in so many ways.
Right.
Yeah.
Is there a deeper, or maybe not so deep, meaning behind the title of the ensemble?
The name comes from, there's a magazine called Poets and Writers that always sort of drove me crazy. Like,
same thing, right?
Yeah. Like, what? Right.
Like, oh, there's poets and writers.
So I don't know where animals and giraffes. I think we were just sitting down one day, and I was like, it's like animals and giraffes or something.
Yeah, and yeah, you're the one that comes up with all the titles.
I see.
And they're perfect, so I can't touch that.
And does each piece contain a written prose or poem?
Yeah, each piece has text by me.
Okay, text, yeah.
And some of them, I don't know if there's any what I would describe as sort of straight up prose. I don't know that it matters that much. There's right. poetry, there's poetry and writing.
Right.
there are pieces that are sort of critical pieces that are written in sort of poem monologue form.
Okay.
And then I try to. I'm not improvising in the way they're improvising, of just, you know, going in and making it in the room. But I am sort of using the text as scores to do structured improvisations within the texts.
The musicians were all, they all had a copy of whatever poem Claudia was going to read in front of them, so they could play along or just listen and play along. There's an interview piece. The piece with David Boyce came out of an interview where Claudia interviews David Boyce.
Mm.
And then I think at one point you said, well, you don't have to just answer with words. If you want, you could answer with your saxophone.
Mm-hmm.
And then he played some things, and then I took all that and mashed it up and made it into a piece.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Philip curated the whole thing. I mean, when we started, I think we did the recording sessions a few years ago, and I hadn't yet moved to the Bay Area. And so he, you know, the only reason all of these musicians said yes is because he asked them.
Tapped into the wellspring of free improvisation.
Most of them had met you and found you to be interesting and thought, well, yeah, I want to do that.
Well, there we go.
It wasn't a total dead weight.
No.
Yeah.
I didn't have to twist anyone's arm.
I see. So then the improvisers, they have some foresight to, you know, what's going to generally happen. But you may, it sounds like you may change the text or change the lines where they're located instantaneously.
What Burroughs called cut-ups.
I see.
Cutting up things.
I mean,
yes.
It's never the same one twice, right?
No, yeah. And some of them are, I work a lot with repetition, or I would just change things and sort of, what do you call it, play the room.
Yeah,
So sometimes things come in that people have said, or just things that go through my mind.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe when we made this, I wasn't quite there yet. Like, we just did a session on KPFA with Wobbly, and for that, and that was 3 hours, and I didn't, by and large, I only spoke
3 hours.
What I wrote in the time, so I brought my computer in and was typing as my instrument, but I wouldn't have been able to do that at the time, or I didn't trust that I could do that when we made this recording.
So you were instantaneously improvising using text at that moment. That's great. I like that, yeah. And will you be doing that on this performance, or you have pre-written material?
I don't know. I will. Half of me was thinking to do that. I also was thinking that it might be interesting to bring in the text that I used with on those different tracks and sort of mash them together and pull things. I'm not sure. I'll see what I feel like when I wake up.
Right. And then the musicians, they have free reign, or is there contextual
there's
elements?
No, it's an improvisation.
It is. Oh, okay, yeah. I see. Yeah. And you got Evelyn Davis playing on this show.
Prepared piano, yeah. John Truba. Aurora. Uh-huh. And Claudia and I. Yeah, it's a five-piece group.
Have you worked with vocalists before this? Before, yeah.
Yeah.
And that, what kind of, how does that incorporate? You know, because you got competing voices, right? Mm-hmm. One's more singing, other one's more text.
I really like it. I've done one live performance that Aurora was part of. Mm-hmm. I mean, she's so incredible.
Oh, yeah. Like,
2+2.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Right. John and I and Claudia and
John Raskin.
Aurora.
Right.
Yeah.
And we also did a 2+2 with Elizabeth Robinson, who's another poet. And I've just started working with Kat Ashley. I think maybe I was getting a little bit restless just being on the page, so it's mm-hmm. exciting. And because I'm not, I don't know, I mean, they're such different things, you know, what I do and what Aurora does.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's very true. Yeah, I was just curious about the interface, you know, within that context.
Yeah. How does it work as far as you're concerned?
How does what work?
The interface.
Well, you're both using your voice in completely different ways, so there's no real, I don't sense that there's any way that there could be conflict, or, do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It's a lovely contrast. I mean, Aurora's a sound artist, and you're...
She's magical.
And you're using words, so...
Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that's
it's like
interesting...
trumpet, piano.
But words are so particular and they have such a tyranny. So
right.
To play with moments when, to the extent that I am ever working as a vocalist, it's in these sort of rudimentary ways of sort of, you know, speaking in such a way so that the words are sort of in ascendancy or in the forefront or sort of become more like, you know,
mm-hmm.
when somebody's just talking quickly and you're not really following. And
mm-hmm.
So... I think playing around with narrative, which is something that I'm really interested in doing in general with writing, and the what how narrative works when it stops working, how something can tell a story that isn't about narrative. So being able to play around with that in conversation with musicians,
mm-hmm.
and I think maybe especially somebody who's using her voice,
mm-hmm.
Is really exciting.
Yeah, that should be interesting, because I don't know if I've actually seen that concept actually live in a live setting.
Mm.
So that's why I was curious about that.
Yeah.
We mixed the record with a conscious decision from time to time to kind of obliterate her voice,
uh-huh.
to obliterate the words, so that it does become sound-like.
Mm.
You know, the way something will inevitably, and even an instrument in an orchestra, inevitably kind of becomes part of the texture or the background and not in the foreground. And I mixed the songs wanting to play with that dynamic.
And that's, you're speaking about the record July that has recently come out.
On Edgetown.
Yeah, right. So just for folks who don't have a context for that. But brand new record in July. So that record actually also contains creative mixing and matching that wasn't done live as well.
Right.
So that's a whole other thing.
Right. Half the tracks are exactly the way they happened in the studio, and the other half are
interesting.
Tried to be a little more creative with the way that we
Right. But then the live show will be, even if you attempt to do these things from the record, they will definitely be different.
Won't be anything
right,
like that.
Because
will
be live.
Yes.
We have no interest
in
recreating something that already exists.
I see, yeah.
And this quintet has never worked together before.
As a quintet.
As a quintet. It'll be different.
Yeah, I think Evelyn's on the record and on the show, but is John? John's on the record.
Yeah, there's a dude. He's going to be playing electric guitar on the concert.
Uh-huh.
He played... The track that's on the record, he's playing acoustic guitar.
Right.
It's the only thing different.
Right.
Yeah.
And on the record, you have Karen Stackpole.
Yeah.
And
who's worked with Animals and Giraffes
in
live with John Bischoff.
Right.
Animals and Giraffes is Claudia and I just we keep wanting to like just go at it with different people, you know, to, and we've done it with dancers, we've done it with a bunch of different folks here in the Bay Area. We want to keep doing that with, I think every time, like, try to do it with someone else, you know, so that something new can come out of it.
So it becomes more of a collective community event.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Exactly. Yes. Great.
Which I know you.
Oh, well, yes.
You know a lot about.
And that's what OutSound likes to do, too. Yeah, exactly. Great. All right. Well, I look forward to your set coming up on July 26th, where also Colette McCaslin, Mark Pino, and Amy Reed will be opening up for you guys.
Yeah, I can't wait to hear that.
And I think the pairing will be quite collaborative, actually, having those two sets in the same evening, texturally, sonically. So,
yeah.
Thanks so much for speaking with me.
Our pleasure.
Thank you for speaking with us and for doing all of this. It's really exciting. Sure. I think one of the things also about this album and this project is that it's really, it's Bay Area.
And very.
It's important. It feels really important that it's coming out on Edgetone. And that,
great. Yeah. Wonderful. All right. Well, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
I gave the man with the skeleton face the chance to get out, and he took it. You wore a white tuxedo. You wore flowers. Your face fell into souffle and never will come back.